Hachette Audio presents Super Founders, what data reveals about billion-dollar startups. Written by Ali Tamaseb. Read by Dean Temple, Catherine Ho, and Jason Culp. Introduction. There are only patterns. Patterns on top of patterns, patterns that affect other patterns, patterns hidden by patterns, patterns within patterns. If you watch close, history does nothing but repeat itself. What we call chaos is just patterns we haven't recognized. What we call random is just patterns we can't decipher. What we can't understand, we call nonsense. What we can't read, we call gibberish. Chuck Palahniuk, Survivor. Years ago, when I was starting my first company, my idea of a successful startup mostly came from movies I'd watched, articles I'd read, and the ever-present popular mythology of famous companies. Facebook's story made me believe that most successful founders start when they're in college, as Mark Zuckerberg did. Apple's story made me believe that you needed two co-founders, one technical genius and one business visionary, to become super successful. It wasn't until much later that I learned Apple actually had a third co-founder at the very beginning. Billion-dollar startups, or unicorns, a term coined by venture capitalist Aileen Lee, are, as their name indicates, relatively rare. They make up less than 0.1% of startups. When I became a venture capital investor years later, I realized what a small and skewed sample had made its way to the media and shaped my perceptions. As a venture capital investor, I review, assess, and track hundreds of startups every year, and have seen some of these companies grow to billion-dollar outcomes. But I still could not tell what was really different between those that did become great successes and those that did not. And perhaps neither could anyone else. At least, not backed by data instead of gut feeling. So I decided to embark on a journey to answer a question that had nagged at me for years. What did billion-dollar startups really look like when they were getting started? Did they stand out from the pack on day one? If so, how? Starting in 2017, I dug through internet archives, read hundreds of interviews, reviewed thousands of LinkedIn and Crunchbase profiles, and studied every public or private data source I could find. I spent thousands of hours over 4 years to gather this data, manually piecing together 30,000 data points, analyzing over 65 factors per startup. I gathered information on everything, from a company's early competitors to its defensibility factors, from the founder's age to their university rank, from the quality of a company's investors to the timing of fundraising rounds, and much, much more. No study is meaningful without comparison to a baseline group, so I also collected the same data on a similar-sized group of randomly selected startups founded in the same time period that didn't go on to billion-dollar valuations. As I was collecting this data, I continued to hear stereotypes perpetuated by other investors and founders about what success looks like. That most billion-dollar companies are started by Ivy League dropouts. That they must have gone through well-known accelerator programs. That the founders must have solved a personal problem, or that their ideas had to be first to market and lack competition. While a handful of billion-dollar startups match these archetypes, most of them don't. My dataset showed that the founders of billion-dollar companies were more likely to have PhDs than be dropouts. Many of them had entirely non-technical co-founders. Fewer than 15% went through any accelerator program, many weren't solving a personal problem, and very few were first to market. I wondered how many companies fail to get funding because they don't match any known patterns. And how many would-be successful founders never start a business in the first place for the same reason, These questions led me to expand outside my dataset, gather firsthand stories from founders of these billion-dollar companies, and not just the well-known ones, and write this book. There were over 200 billion-dollar companies founded in the time period of my study, between 2005 and 2018, many of which you may not have heard of. Besides the Ubers, Airbnbs, and Zooms featured in this book, there are billion-dollar startup companies like Nevro, maker of a medical device that uses electrical stimulation of the nerves to reduce chronic pain as an alternative to drugs, or Tanium, which develops endpoint security management software. There are also many examples of billion-dollar startups outside the typical tech hubs, like Peak, an Istanbul-based developer of popular mobile games. The data informs my argument, and my interviews with founders and investors, which appear at the end of all but a couple of chapters, color in the details. In the chapter on work experience, you'll hear about how two founders were able to disrupt the cancer treatment technology market without any industry experience. In the chapter on pivots, you'll hear about how YouTube was formed from a pivot. In the chapter on bootstrapping, you'll hear about GitHub's early-stage financing for over 4 years before being acquired for $7.5 billion. And in the chapter on fundraising, you'll hear about how companies like Peloton and Airbnb struggled with raising funds in the early days. You'll see that some of my research shows that certain factors don't matter at all, so let yourself off the hook and stop worrying. And you'll also see some factors that made a founder or idea more likely to succeed and just might inspire you to change your thinking. I'll answer questions like, how many startups had multiple competitors at the time of founding? How many years of overall work experience did the founders have before starting their company? Was it in the same industry? Had most founders started another company before? If so, was their previous attempt successful? How long did it take from when they started to when they got their first investment? Was it from a brand name investor or not? In addition to the data, the interviews are a chance to hear the more nuanced stories directly from a few of these founders. In some cases, they are a representative sample of the data, and in other cases, they are outliers. The outliers are important too. They demonstrate that sometimes you can succeed even in the face of data that shows otherwise. We will hear from Max Levchin, co-founder of PayPal and Affirm, on market creation versus expansion. From Tony Fadell, founder of Nest and the inventor of the iPod, on product differentiation. From Michelle Zatlin, co-founder of Cloudflare, on starting a company during the recession. And from Eric Yuan, founder of Zoom, on competition. We will talk with Peter Thiel, an investor in companies like Facebook, SpaceX, and Spotify. Alfred Lin of Sequoia Capital, an investor in companies like Airbnb and DoorDash. And Keith Raboy of Founders Fund, an investor in companies like YouTube and LinkedIn, about what they look for when listening to a pitch and how startups should best prepare for fundraising. I sat down with each of these experts and asked them questions about their backgrounds, their startup formation or investment stories, how they ran their companies, and much more. My dataset includes any startup that at one point passed the billion-dollar valuation, whether by going public via an initial public offering or IPO, by getting acquired, or in private funding rounds. So my study is defined more broadly than just private investor valuations, which is what is usually referred to as a unicorn. Some might argue that the value of a unicorn is only on paper. Indeed, many are overvalued or lose their status later on. Still, most billion-dollar startups are breakthrough phenomena. After all, the average startup typically fails and dies, while the average billion-dollar startup employs hundreds of people and creates products used by thousands of customers. Valuation is not the ideal metric to define success per se, but with the lack of available data on revenues, profit, or societal impact of these companies, it's a good, if arbitrary, way to draw a line around what to study. My hope is that the insights in this book will be not just eye-opening, but also useful and practical on your own entrepreneurial journeys. Some founders may try to conform to certain narratives, build teams in specific ways, or shape their startups to fit stereotypes. Here, we'll use data to figure out what really matters. You will learn
that those. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.